Welcome, everyone. We want to thank you for being a part of our program today. This is Freedom, Victory Through the Word of God. And we just want you to come in to where we're at today and listen to some of the things that God has helped us through. We all three have suffered fear and anxiety. This is Linda Long on my left, Carlene Gray on my right, and we want to welcome you to be a part of this program today. We hope that something we say through the Word of God in this program today will help you to be free from the spirit of fear. God delivered us because He said He did not give us that spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. And the enemy comes in to attack our minds to bring in a spirit of fear over us, whatever you've walked through, whether you'd been sickness, whether it'd been death, whether it'd been financial needs, or whatever you've walked through, the enemy will come in to tell you that you're not going to live, that, you know, you're going to die, just different tactics that the enemy uses to come in over your mind. And today, we're going to help give you scriptures through the Word of God that's going to help you set you free and tell you about maybe some of the experiences that we've walked through and the Word that we've held on to that brought us out. We know that there is a God in heaven today that can help bring you through. And if you don't know Him, we pray that you have a personal experience with Jesus Christ like we did. And we held on to this Word when we were going through the fire, when we were going through the trouble, and God delivered us through the Word of God. And so today we want to bring that Word to you. Psalm 91, we're going to talk about for a little bit, how God used Psalm 91 in my life to help bring me through the fire, help me bring through. I quoted that. I learned it.
Oh, I know. I did.
I sought that Psalm 91 out.
I still
left it open
that.
In my bedroom. I took it to bed with me. I read it day and night. And when the enemy would come in, I would run to Psalm 91. I don't care where I was at. I carried a Bible in my car. I was in Walmart. I couldn't shop. I would get to the back of the store. The doctor had written me out a prescription. He said, "You need to take medicine." And I said, "I don't want to take medicine, but you not get better," he said, "if you don't take medicine." And I knew that there was power through the Word of God. You can have as much of God as you want. You know, the Bible said the deep calleth unto the deep. And I wanted God. I wanted Him. I wanted to know that He could deliver me. I wanted to hang on to that Word. He's healed me many times.
Right.
He's brought me through the fire. He's took me through the fiery trial. And when I started suffering this in 2005, my daughter was living in Nashville. And she said, "Mom, let me come home." And I said, "No, there's no sense in you driving home. I will get through this." And it took a while. I mean, it wasn't instantaneously where it just happened overnight. I walked through it. But you will learn that if you will take that trial that you're going through, no matter whether it's fear, anxiety, depression, whatever it is, if you stay in the Word of God, you can be a conqueror. And God allows you to walk through those things, through that fire, to help someone else. So today we're going to talk about the spirit of fear and how it comes in and how it engulfs you, how it overcomes you. And we pray today that this program will be a blessing to you.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, we can talk about anxiety, we can talk about fear, and, you know, we know what it is, but how do you get the courage to fight the fear? You know, you can't do it by yourself.
No.
You know, people will say, I know they would tell me, "Just snap out of it, just snap." I'd be like, how in the world can I snap out of it? You know, I'm scared here.
Yeah.
You know, fear is
horrible.
You're scared.
Yes.
You know, and for me, I was scared that I was going to have a nervous breakdown, lose my mind. And that sounds ridiculous. I know. But when you're in that fear, you feel like you don't really have control because you feel like that your mind is so bombarded and you're saying, "What is going on?" And that's the way with me. I'm like, "What happened to me?" And one of my best friends, and her name is Carol, I won't give her last name, but we've been friends our whole life, you know, and I would be like, "Why can't I be like Carol?" You know, what's going on with me? You feel like that there's been a new page that's been turned over in your life and something has happened to you. And it is, because Satan fights your mind. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But when I found the scripture, "God has not given me the spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind," I thought, well, if God's not giving me this fear, where is it coming from? So it's coming from the enemy. And once I got that scripture, that gave me hope. But I'm like you. I didn't just wake up the next day. I'm like, okay, I'm good. No, I had to figure out what to do in order to overcome
and
to be free. And I had to fight with everything in me.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I fought the battle, but God's word fought the battle for me.
It's the word.
And that's the thing that we had to realize here is that it takes God's word. We're not against medication.
No.
You know, we took the medicine.
I didn't.
I'm not judging anybody.
One day.
That's what I'm saying, though. But there were days where I would, you know, say, okay, I'm going to take the Xanax or I'm going to take the Prozac or whatever.
Right.
And so I'm not judging anybody because
we're
when you're just reaching for help at that point. But, you know, that didn't help me, you know. And I was like you. I was like, God, I'm your child.
It brought more fear on me.
Yeah, it did me too.
It did me too. Yeah.
I was scared of the Prozac. And then, but I did take the Xanax for a while. And then it gets to where you've got a problem because now one Xanax isn't working. Now, you know, you're waking up in the middle of the night where when you used to just take a Xanax and go to sleep. And, you know, then now it's like, okay, the Xanax isn't working, you know.
Or have to have a stronger
dose. And then I was so scared of being addicted. So then I was like, okay, you know, what do I do? And then God moved one night on me. I woke up in a full-blown panic attack. And I was like, God, if you will help me. And I once again reached for God. There was still that hope in me that I knew that God could help me.
Yes.
But Satan was always saying, you were out in sin and you did all this stuff before you became a Christian. So God's not going to help you.
Right.
You know,
that's
you're not Vonda,
tactics.
You're not Carlene, you know, and
we're
that's
not
what
supposed to be.
that's what Satan was telling me. And that's a lie. That's
all to use your past against you.
Exactly.
Yes.
But when I started finding in the word that we're saved by grace and that what Jesus did on the cross is enough and it works for me, you,
everybody.
Vonda, he's no respect to person, and started getting those scriptures and realizing that, wait, there's promises for me. And I started taking those promises and started quoting those promises.
Yes.
I quoted those promises when I was scared. Every time I was scared, you know, I would take those scriptures. I'd lay on my bed at night and put, you know, earphones on or whatever, and I'd listen to those scriptures, and I'd lay there, and I would cry. Tears would run down my face because I'm like, God, I need help so bad.
And did you feel like, God, are you ever going to help me?
Right.
I mean, when you're fighting that battle and you're walking in it, you feel like you're walking alone. Even though somebody else has already went through it, you still feel like you're all alone because the devil makes you feel, the enemy of your soul makes you feel like you're just shut away from everybody. So you have to have a scripture. You have to have a word. You have to eat it day and night.
Right.
You have to get that in your spirit, man, that I'm going to eat this word no matter what I'm feeling, whether it's sickness, fear, anxiety, whatever. It's all the same. It's through the word of God that we are set free.
Right.
Victory in the word.
Well, and his word tells us that his word is medicine to us.
Right.
So if we're going to take the word, then, hey, we're going to get some benefits from the word.
Yes.
And that brings faith cometh by hearing.
Yes.
And hearing by the word of God.
So,
you know, you say, well, I don't have enough faith to be healed. I don't have enough faith to walk out of this. So how do you get more faith? I'm getting off track a little bit, but you get the faith that you need to get that healing and to grab onto that healing. You get it from
the word.
Faith cometh by hearing. Hearing what?
The word.
Hearing by
the word.
Yes.
Faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So when we hear the word of God, it does something to our spirit, man. And that's where you need to be in order to walk out. And to get to the point, for me, I had to get to the point to where when Satan would say, you're going to have a nervous breakdown, you're going to end up in an institution, I had enough that word. I had eaten enough of that word that I was like, no, I'm not.
Yes.
I don't even believe you anymore, devil. Get out of here in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
I didn't believe it anymore.
Yeah.
But I had to get to that point where I faced it.
It almost makes you want to vomit that out, what this enemy tries to put in there. Because
it's
when it hits the word in your spirit, it goes against it, and you want to vomit that out.
No, that's not, and that's where but it took me about 6 months.
Oh, I went through it for a long time.
And I, you know, I had
years.
People praying for me all the time, and you would feel better when you'd get prayed for. But God allows you to face those things so that it doesn't have control over you anymore.
Right.
That's the thing. So you know that you know that you know. That no, not having a nervous breakdown. No, I'm not a lunatic here. You know, I'm God's child, and he's going to take care of me.
Right. Well, one scripture, Linda, that helped me so much was Psalm 118, where he said, I shall not die, but live mm-hmm. and declare the works of the Lord. And I would quote that scripture. You know, I'm not going to die, because the tactic of fear, the core of fear, the very root of fear is death. And that's what the enemy uses against people, that spirit comes on, because it is a spirit. We've recognized that and we know that. So you got to know what you're dealing with. But that's what happened to me. You know, the enemy would say, okay, you're going to die. So I would have to quote that Psalm 91, because there's life in Psalm 91. And I would go to Psalm 118 and I would say, no, I am not going to die. I am going to finish my call. I have a destiny. I'm going to preach the gospel. I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that, because you got to start talking back right. to that voice that talks to you. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't give it opposition, then it comes in and takes a stronghold, a hold of your life. So what we were doing when we were going through it, we were fighting. We were battling that. We were saying, you're not going to succumb me. You're not going to overcome me, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And that spirit mm-hmm. is of the world.
Right. Yeah. And we don't fight like, okay, I put
no,
your dukes up.
You fight with the word.
What do we fight? We fight the good fight of faith.
Yes,
that's all we have to do, is fight the good fight
exactly.
of faith, which is, what does the word say about my situation? Right. I choose to stand on the word. That's fighting
yes.
the fight of faith.
Yes.
And the Bible says that the power of life and death are in the tongue.
That's right.
So we got to start training ourselves to start speaking good
right.
things over ourselves and not speak bad things. If
right.
we continually say, I'm sick, I'm depressed, I'm lonely, I'm all these things, the more we speak that, the more that is going
takes
to suppress us.
Mm-hmm.
But we got to start speaking life.
Yes.
Because
right.
there, you know, the power of death and life and death is in the tongue.
In the tongue.
But I was thinking about what you said, and I started thinking, Jesus told Peter, so if you're a Christian out there and you're battling these fears and anxiety,
mm-hmm.
don't think you're alone, because there's so many Christians that are walking through
mm-hmm.
this.
Yes.
But I was reminded of Peter in the Bible, when Jesus looked at him and he said, Peter, he said, the devil desires to sift you as wheat.
Right.
But Jesus said, I have prayed for you
yes.
that your faith fail you not.
Christ prayed for him.
He prayed for him. So he was with Jesus, and
mm-hmm.
Jesus was still saying, Peter, I prayed for you that your faith fail you not.
Right.
So we've got to feed our faith.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Absolutely.
We
yeah.
have to feed our faith.
Yes.
Because what we feed grows, and what we starve dies.
Right.
So if we feed on the Word of God and we feed that faith, then even though the devil wants to sift you, and he wants to take your calling away from you.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to take your ministry away
everything.
From you. And there's pastors out there that are walking through the valley.
Mm-hmm.
And if I read right, the statistics are that there's so many pastors that are walking
giving
off the
up.
Pulpits and leaving their churches. But if you're a pastor today, I want to remind you of what the Word says, that you are made more than an overcomer. You are a conqueror. So don't give up in the battle.
Yes. Right.
And this is what I tell my son when the battle gets hot. I said, you can't leave.
Mm-mm.
You got to stay and fight the good fight of
yes.
faith.
Mm-hmm.
When the battle gets
your
hot, you got to fight.
You do. You got to put your armor on. The Bible talks about the armor, Ephesians chapter 6, for us to put on the whole armor of God
right.
that you may be able to stand against the enemy.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And you've got to get girded up.
Right.
You know, gird
mm-hmm.
your loins with truth and put the breastplate of salvation on and the shield of faith. And you got to be able to arm yourself against the enemy. And how do we arm ourselves? We arm ourselves through the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
And it's no time for us to be discouraged or defeated or cast down. You know, we need to pick up our armor, pick up our shield, and begin to fight with the Word of God.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. Well, we go back to, I think it was our first session that we did, our first taping that we did. We were talking about anxiety. And I want to just remind people that whatever you are sowing,
mm-hmm.
there's a law. God's
mm-hmm.
law.
Mm-hmm.
People call it karma, but it's God's
not,
law,
it's God's law.
Yeah.
That whatever you sow, you're going to reap.
That's why
so
you
need to stop saying, I'm going to lose my mind.
Mm-hmm.
I'm scared I'm going to die. Well, if I'm here this time next year, all that stuff, you need to stop that, because you're sowing seed.
Yes.
And, you know, go back to Genesis, where God, whatever he spoke and whatever came up, it always produced after its kind.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you plant corn,
you're going to get corn.
You're not getting green beans.
Right.
You know, you're getting corn, you know. And so that's why it's important that whatever you're speaking, and that's what I kept thinking, I have to be careful what I speak, because if I, whatever I'm speaking, it's going to come up.
Right.
And that's what I was speaking. I'm going to have a nervous breakdown. I'm going to, you know, I'm not going to be able to raise my kids. And I was planting that, which made more fear.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So we need to be careful, even in the battle, even though you're scared, be careful what you're speaking. Say, you know, no, God didn't give me the spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. Your heart might be racing out of, and going crazy inside.
Yeah, palm sweat. You know,
you feel lightheaded, you feel disoriented, all that stuff. And you just want to, we talked earlier about you just want to just, if you're in your car, you want to jump out of your car and just go running down the road because you just are so overwhelmed by
to get home
the anxiety.
I felt like if I was
That's
home,
your safe
I
place.
Get safe.
That's
know,
your
I
safe place.
Or if I could get in the car and get a hold of my Bible and say, you know, this is what the word says, I'd call Carlene. I would say, this is what the word says, or I'd call you, and you know, this is what the word says, and we would quote the word to each other,
right,
and lift each other up. And it's fear is scary.
It is very scary.
And you talked about a minute ago about being able to confront that fear. You generally, and I mean, I'm telling you from my experience, you have to get to the point so strong in God that you face that fear. Because if you don't face something, you'll never conquer it.
Mm-hmm.
David had to face the giant, you know?
Right.
And Saul tried to give David his armor. And David said, no, I haven't tried that armor. I got to use what I know. Mm-hmm. You got to use what you learn, what you know in the Word of God. And David took one stone. This came to me Sunday night in church. You know, we're winners. The Bible says we're winners. We're automatically a winner in Christ Jesus. We're an overcomer. But your miracle may be one stone throw away. And people are ready to walk away from what they fought, their battle, and everything else you've been through. But it was only one stone, Carlene, that killed that giant. Right. One stone away from your answer. One stone away from your promise. And the enemy will talk to you and tell you to give up the fight. There's no use. I had a lady call me last night, and I began to pray for her. And she was scared. She had fear on her. She was crying. She was just, you know, I'm in my house, and there's somebody out there. I've had to call the sheriff's department. And fear was there. I mean, she was generally afraid. And I began to pray for her on the phone, and I began to quote this scripture. And this scripture comes to me in Psalm 91. Verse 5, there shall not be afraid for the terror of night, nor the arrow that flieth by noonday. Don't be afraid of the terror at night. And I started speaking life to her. I started quoting scriptures and giving her places to go read. And then I texted her to check on her a couple hours later. It was 2 a.m, you know, and I was up, you know, worried about whether she was okay or not. And you know, and all this. And she texted me this morning. I slept 4 hours last night. She hadn't slept in 3 or 4 days because of this onslaught of the enemy to have fear over her life. But through the Word of God, we can have peace. We can be overcomers. And God delivers us from the spirit of fear, and we're not bound by that spirit. Sometimes you have to face that fear. That's you have to face that thing that's coming at you.
Right, exactly.
And Linda, you were talking about your past, how that the enemy would bring your past in front of you. But the Bible says that God, when we get saved and we repent, that He throws our sins into the sea of forgetfulness.
Yes, that came to me while she was saying
Thank God.
Yeah.
So if we think about our past, God's like, what are you talking about?
Exactly.
I don't remember that.
God doesn't remember our past anymore. Isn't that awesome?
People would only do that.
Isn't that awesome?
Right.
I mean, He doesn't remember
that.
So when the enemy's trying to bring it up to us, of course, the enemy's going to do whatever he can to try to bombard your mind.
Right.
Because the mind is where the enemy likes to, that's his playground, is in our mind. But it's nice. It's a miracle to know that our sins, God doesn't even remember them.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Isn't that awesome?
Right.
It's wonderful.
Yes.
That's the kind of God we
serve. So
your
awesome.
Past has no power over your future.
No, that's the good thing.
Your past has absolutely no power over your future. So your past is behind you.
When you accept
You tell
Christ.
Satan when he comes at you and tries to bring your past up to you, you say, you know what, Satan, you might remember my past, but God doesn't. And my sins have been thrown into the sea of forgiveness, and my past has no power over what I'm going to do in the future, because I am going to go for the Lord. I'm going to do His will. I'm going to walk in the power of God, and I'm going to do what God's called me to do. It doesn't matter what my past was.
Yes. That's right. That's right. Well, Satan can hold fear over you. He can keep you in fear through those thoughts.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. You know, say, oh, what if? What if? Yeah. What if I'm not a? What if I'm really not saved? Or what if, you know, God doesn't care enough for me? It's all fear.
Yeah. It's fear.
And we need to watch what's in our mind and what's hanging out there. Don't let it hang out there.
Cast it down.
Somebody said, you know, you can't help if a bird flies over your head. Just don't let it build a nest.
Right. Yeah. That's exactly right. I've heard that all my life.
Yeah.
But the word says, God said, if you abide in me and my word abides in you, you can ask what you will. To abide, I thought about what it means to abide. When you abide in your home, it means you live there.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You live there. That's your refuge.
Dwelling
when you said that you went to your house because it felt like that was your refuge, to go to your home. You know, they used to have cities of refuge in the Bible where people that were accused of doing things that
went there for
they
safety.
Didn't do, they would go to the city of refuge, and they would hide them there, and they would take care of them and guard them. Well, we need to run to our refuge, which is God.
The rock.
Right.
Like we talked about in the last program, the rock.
The rock.
And, and you know, God's word says that his word is a lamp unto our feet. So I want to say that, when we're using the word, when we're quoting the scripture, light is going forward. You come in a room and the room is all dark. When you flip the switch on, that darkness leaves.
Right.
That's what happens when you use the word. That darkness that's tormenting you, it has to leave, because the Bible says the darkness can't comprehend the light.
That's right. That's good.
Yeah.
That's good.
Well, another scripture that came to me was in Psalm 91. It said, "There shall no evil befall thee," verse 10, "neither shall any plague come nigh to thy dwelling, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways." And when we pray these words, these scriptures, and they come alive and come alive inside of us, those angels are dispatched from heaven. You think about that, how much God cares about us. We have guardian angels that encamped about us to keep us in all of our ways, lest we should dash our foot against a stone. So thank God today for the power of Jesus Christ, the power that he came to set the captive free, bind the brokenhearted, heal all of their wounds, and we can have that freedom through salvation today. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, we are more than overcomers. He washes away our sins, casts them in the sea of forgetfulness, never to be remembered again. And when I was getting ready today, girls, to come down here, I was in the bathroom. I'm always praying in the bathroom. That's my solitude place. That's where I go to seek the Lord. But he was talking to me about people judging one another, not judging another man's salvation. You know, you might have people that come to you and say, "Well, you're not really saved," or "You did this," or "You did that." Your salvation is between you and Christ. You accept Christ as your personal Savior. He comes and lives in your heart. You might mess up. You might make a mistake, but don't let somebody else cast you down and tell you that you're not saved, because your salvation is between you and Christ. And if you make a mistake, the Bible says you have an advocate with the Father, that you can go to him and say, "God, I repent. I messed up here." How many times have we had to do that? Nobody here sitting today is a perfect Christian. Nobody here is not without sin or has never made a mistake. We all make mistakes, but we know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. So that's when you go back to the Father. So when I was going through this fear, I continuously, and I still do today, check myself, check my heart. Were those with right intentions? Did I say that with the right attitude? Did I do this? Did I do that? And when I was studying last night, I went to 1 John chapter 4 and verse 18. It said, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear, because fear hath torment." And fear does have torment.
Yes, it does.
"And he that have fear is not made perfect in love." So I would go back, and I still do today, which I don't ever want that spirit of fear to come back on me again. That was one of the worst things that I ever fought in my life. But I said, "God, let my heart have perfect love. Perfect love cast out all fear." So we have to go back and check our lives sometimes and say, "God, am I walking in that love that I need to?" When you're going through a battle, when you're even beyond fear, when you're going through something, you know, "God, am I walking the way I need to walk? Am I talking the way I need to talk? Am I doing what I need to do?" And sometimes we get delivered through that word. You know, "Let me have more love. Fill my day every way." We used to sing this old song, "Fill my way every day with love, Lord. Let me walk," you know, in that way. So that's another scripture that might help you today. Check yourself. You know, say, "God, how am I living? How am I walking? Am I doing everything that you want me to do? Am I forgiving enough?" Because the Bible says in Mark chapter 11, verse 23, 24, "If you say unto this mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea, and doubt not in your heart that it shall be done." But the next verse says that if we walk in forgiveness, we have to forgive one another. We have to love one another. And that's another thing that will deliver you from the bondage that you're walking in.
Right.
Forgiveness. Unforgiveness is like a disease. It will eat you from the inside out.
It will. You've got to let things go. Sometimes you're walking in fear and you've held on to things in your life, and you have to let those things go. You have to say, "I'm not going to hold on to that anymore." And it may have brought you into a dark place. It may have brought you into depression. It may have tried to seclude you from family and friends and all these things you're walking through. Sometimes you just have to let it go. You just have to say, "You know, God, I turn this over to you, and I'm not going to deal with it anymore," because he knows everything anyway.
Right. Well, and you may feel that the person that has hurt you, they really don't deserve to be forgiven. Yeah. And, you know, that's God's business. I mean, we've all been hurt,
right,
and we want to get revenge or we want to get even. But you can't do that.
No.
And you know, you forgive because we need Christ to forgive us. And if you don't forgive and you hold on to a grudge, you're being held in bondage.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so you need let God deal with that person. Just give it to God and say, God, you know what they did, but you know, I'm going to release them
release
to you. It doesn't mean they're going to get off and not pay for their sin. They will.
Because God said, vengeance is mine, saith
let
the
him
Lord.
Take
he said
care
he would repay.
Well,
yeah,
sometimes if we hold on to it too, you just think about this. Sometimes, you know, the enemy will tell you, if you hold on to this, then you're going to make them pay.
Or yeah,
you're, you know, and that's another, you know, this is another whole program.
I know.
But, you know, we can't, we got to let go. We got to let go of things that hurt us. And I'm telling you, with you letting go, you'll receive a healing. Yeah. You'll receive a healing yourself when you let go of that hurt.
I have a scripture in Proverbs chapter 9, verse 9 says, talking about the refuge, the house of refuge. The Lord, it says, the Lord will also be a refuge for the oppressed, a refuge in times of trouble.
Amen.
And then, Linda, I was thinking about what you said about our future and, you know, how our past has no power over our future, as I was saying. Jeremiah 29:11 is one of my favorite verses. And God said, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. So God has good thoughts toward us. He doesn't think anything evil toward
us. He does not. No.
To give us an end that he wants us to have, a peace and joy and love, a sound mind, and to bring us into the fullness of his joy.
Amen. Amen. And when you get delivered from fear, we've all been delivered today. We're not sitting here ministering to you and telling you that we have been delivered. We don't fight that spirit of fear. It doesn't come nigh our dwelling. We draw the line and we say, no, you're not coming here. We know how to fight you. We know how to battle with you. And this program is to help you. It's to give you the Word of God through victory in the Word, through freedom. And I want to give some scriptures today that you can write down, that you can study at home, because we want to be an informational place for you to come to. So I want to give them some scriptures today, and then I'm going to have one of these ladies pray in closing. But Psalm 27 is a very, very strong chapter in the Bible. Psalm 40, Psalm 46, Psalm 43, Psalm 6, and Psalm 61. Those are some places besides Psalm 91. Those are some places that you can go to. You can write those scriptures down. You can hang on to them. We can't do your work for you. We can give you the information. We can give you biblical principles that God used to help us fight. But you have to get in the Word. You have to study the Word. You have to cling on to it. You have to get a verse to hang on to. So today, we want to thank you for joining us once again, being a part of Victory through the Word. And freedom. We're here to help you get set free, and it is possible. It is possible. All things are possible with God. So if one of them want to say something and lead us in prayer.
Well, I would like to say, we've said this a couple of months ago during our taping, but if you would like to have one of these God's Promises books, they're free. They are subject form, so you can, whatever
we
you're dealing with.
We have somebody asked for one today.
Right. And God has blessed me during my group. I have a Monday night group, support group, God's Cure for Anxiety. It's at 6:30 at 250 Erie Avenue. So if you want to come to that, get on my website, godscureforanxiety.com. Or if you want one of these books, email me at godscureforanxiety@live.com. And I will send you one of these books for free. And then you will be equipped so that you can use the scriptures that we use to overcome.
Amen.
And it's good to have something like that in your possession that you can turn to. And
quickly.
Yes. And I think it's alphabetical order, right? Where it's, you can turn to, different things. Give us an example there, Linda.
Well, just open up and it says experiencing fear. So, you know, on page 120, you can just go there and all these scriptures here show you that these are scriptures to help you fight fear. You know, if you're feeling depressed, you know, there's for the mentally disturbed one, you know, you can go right there to that one too. So we would love to help you, equip you.
Amen.
We've got to help people and equip them to be overcomers.
Equip
is the word
right there.
Yeah.
We need to equip you.
Well,
yes.
We'll be back again with you. We thank you for being a part of this program for the month of March, and we will see you in April. We welcome spring, and we're excited about what God is doing through Victory in the Word. God bless you.